us the only hope for our country.
Stand and worship with us the first. through, but maybe if we're not awake enough, maybe we'll have to get them on stuff. But we're glad you're here nonetheless. And I want to just share something. It's been just one of those years, one of those weeks. But guess what? We have a God that's in charge, don't we?
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25 says, "Not forsaking our own assembling together, as it is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day growing." How important it is to come together collectively as a body of believers, especially in the days that we're living. And I hope you've been praying for this service this week, and I hope you've prepared your heart and come to the Lord and brought those things before Him. But if you haven't, can we just take a few minutes and whatever burdens on your heart, whatever discouragement maybe the evil one is attacking you with, take that time and just lay it down before Him. And let's prepare our hearts for today's service. And let's lift our pastor up. Right. So let's take a few moments, and then after that, we'll collectively pray together. As we come before you, Lord, as we prepare our hearts to receive the message that you've laid on our pastor's heart, we lift him up to you and we ask that you would speak your truth through him. Allow your word to convict our hearts. Help us to understand your word better. And help us to be the light and the salt that you call us to be in the world that we're living in. As the days grow darker and darker, that light that's within us from you shines brighter and brighter. The world is looking for you, whether they realize it or not, whether they want to or not. You are the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through you. We're thankful for your Son, Lord, that paid the price so we can have eternal life. He died and shed his blood on Calvary. But it didn't stop there. He rose 3 days later in victory and conquered death. Father, help us to have the strength of faith that can only come through you, and that hope only comes from you. We ask that you would put a hedge of protection around the service today. And we ask that you would keep the evil one out of this place, as he would like to distract and destroy whatever's going on here. But we know that the power comes from you. And that power can't be diminished in any way. So we're thankful that we can be gathered here today in your word. In your house. And we're thankful for all that you've given to us. Let us glorify you today in what we say and what we do. And we ask all these things in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. You may be seated. A few announcements that we have. Of course, January 27th, the prayer meeting, and then January 31st, communion and a business meeting will be taking place. And of course, we have Christ Seekers February 3rd, and then prayer meeting also February 3rd. And tonight, we're going over the book of Titus. And if you get a chance to come tonight, make sure you do. It's a blessing. Is there any other announcements at this time? Okay. Is there any birthdays?
Screen.
be seated. And at this time, Steve Raymond has a special.
I don't know about you, but I've noticed around, even Christians, good solid Christians, lately have been angry and their demeanor has been changing. These times that we're going through, people have their own opinions and things really affect all of us. But one thing last Sunday when we left church, I was thinking about just turning our eyes upon Jesus. Get our eyes off of all this stuff that's going around. Not only do we feel like sometimes that the election was stolen, but sometimes I feel that our joy and our strength is stolen by getting so involved in all the things that are around when all we really need to do is turn our eyes on Jesus.
Thank you.
tonight's Kansas.
Morning, everyone.
Morning.
Until the snow's on the way. All God's people said, praise the Lord, right? Brandon's been praying to that end. So if you get too much snow, you know who to pick it up with. Well, I titled the message this morning, Strong Men in Tough Times. And the world we're living in is a difficult day. Steve appreciated the song and the message. Good stuff. Absolutely great stuff. Great music this morning. And it's good counsel for us today. We need to be strong men and women in these days in which we're living in. Let's look to the Lord in prayer this morning, and then we'll get into the Word this morning. Father, it's good to be in your house. It's good to be able to open this, your Word, and look at your Word, and counsel you back for us. Father, nothing catches you by surprise. We know that, and we're thankful for that. And Father, you have a Word of admonition for us that is always right and up to date. And we'll minister to the needs of our heart if our ears are open, if we'll just listen to you, Father. Help us not to have a stiff neck and a heart that's resistant to your Word, but help our heart to be open and receptive. Because you want to speak to each and every one of us this morning that are your children. We talked last Sunday about a storm is coming. And now today we want to talk about strong men in the midst of the storm. And that's what it's going to take. And Father, we know today that you want to speak to each and every one of us today about something maybe in our life. Maybe something is down the road and a decision we need to make. Or maybe, Father, there's some here today that maybe don't even know you as their Lord and Savior. They got a head knowledge, but they got absolutely no heart experience. There's no change. There's no evidence of the saving faith in their life. And so, Father, this morning you're speaking to them about their soul, their condition, their lost condition. Every one of you way in this service, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Maybe you've had the privilege. If you've been in the hospital room with a loved one or maybe someone that was dear to your family and they were living out their very last hours on this earth and in a matter of a short time they were going to be going out into eternity and maybe they had some cognitive moments in that time of dying. They might have looked up to you and spoke to you and spoke words that was really near and dear on their heart that they wanted you to hear. And it sticks in your mind all these years later, even after they have passed. When you take your Bible and you turn to the 17th chapter of the book of John, this is called Christ's High Priestly Prayer. And Christ was about to offer himself upon the cross for your sins and my sins. As you read this chapter. And as he prays for himself first. He prays that he will glorify his heavenly Father, that he will accomplish the purpose. There was no question that he would accomplish the purpose. He came to do that, did he not? He came to die for your sins and mine. But you have to understand, he's God, he's man. And the man, the flesh, he prays that he would do all that he was set upon to do. As I said, there's no question to do it. But still, the flesh, each and every one of us in the flesh, we have moments in the flesh, do we not? Our flesh doesn't always do what we like our flesh to do sometimes. He prays for himself, but then he also prays for his disciples. These men that he has walked with and taught and trained, these men have no clue yet what's coming down the pike. Their eyes are going to be enlightened like they've never been enlightened. Jesus is going to die. Jesus is going to resurrect from the grave, and they're going to see the resurrected Lord in his new and glorified body. They're in the scars on his hands and on his side, but they're going to see. And they're going to believe like they've never believed. They thought they believed before, you are the Savior, you are the Messiah. But they had like taken those spools and into your toilet paper roll, you know, those terrible things. And you look down, best illustration I can think of. And you look down through those and you can't see very much, can you? That's all they could see of what Christ was going to do in the future. But after the resurrection, their vision was greatly enhanced. so they could see like they'd never seen. They got understanding like they never had understanding. And when the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost and began to empower these men, what did they do? They went out across the face of their world and they began to preach the gospel. And Jesus, as he prays here in the 17th chapter, he prays for them because he knew what they were going to experience. Yes, sir, there was a storm coming. They didn't realize the storm that was coming. And they needed to be strong men at that hour because they were going to really be put to the test. And every last one of them died a martyr's death with the exception of John. And John was a misfire. They tried to boil John. John didn't boil well. And they left him on the island of Patmos. And there you know the story of John, the Gospel of John. You have the Gospel, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and the book of Revelation. But Jesus says he prays for something else. He prays for all of those men and women, you and I, in the fullness of time ahead. As he is about to go to the cross, he prays for you and I. The life that we're going to live, the challenges that we're going to experience. He includes you and I in that prayer for those of us who know Christ as our Savior. In John chapter 17, verse 18, it says, as thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. Now he sent his disciples, but he's also, if you read on down through here, he's praying for each and every one of us. The world that we're going to live in, the world that we're going to make our mark in, the world that we're going to testify of the saving faith that we've experienced. And it could be a difficult world. It's not going to be a perfect world. And the world that we're living in is far from perfect. Last Sunday night, we had a little bit of a testimony time where we asked people to share testimony when they came to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And that's an important thing that we share our testimony when we came to Christ. Never forget the road that you were on, the road that was taking you to an eternal damnation. I don't know about you. I had to do something today. I woke up this morning. I couldn't sleep. I woke up this morning and I was having some prayer time. And you'll never guess who I began to pray for. Joe Biden. Kamala Harris. Nancy Pelosi. That woman needs to be saved. Schumer. He is a piece of work. And the Lord brought names to mind to people that disgust me seriously. But I know that as a believer, we need to pray for one another. Now, they're not believers by no means. But never forget the road you're on because they're on the highway to hell. I'll assure you, you say, Pastor, you're being pretty judgmental. No, I'm just kind of looking for fruit on the tree. And I can see the fruit on the tree. And pretty obvious, that tree is deader than dead. And it needs to be born again. Never forget the road that you were on and where you came from. And maybe the person who shared Christ with you and how you came to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. It's important that we share our testimony. And what happened? Well, we recognized that we were a sinner. We know what sin is. The nice way of saying what sin is a transgression of the law of God. I was talking to my sister the other night. And she was sharing with me how they had a couple 3 a.m. prayer meeting. And I said, well, we had 18 last Sunday night. And she has a bigger church from which we are. And she only had a couple 3 in her prayer meeting. And she was bemoaning the fact. And I reminded her, I said, you know, one thing you need to remember, there's a lot of people that have prayed the sinner's prayer. But not everybody really understands what sin is. And friend, if you don't understand what sin is, I beg to differ with your praying, but you need to understand what sin is before you pray the sinner's prayer. You need to understand that you're a sinner and what you need to be saved from, that your sin will separate you from God. Sin of any kind, sin of any stripe, causes us to fall short of the mark of God's righteousness. Sin is depicted as a filthy rag. In order to be saved, I need to cry out to never forget what happened when you trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Well, when I read here the 17th chapter, Jesus not only prayed for these men to be saved, prayed for these men in their ministry, but he also prays for what happens after we're saved. And what happens after we're saved? Well, the Bible says, if you take your Bible and turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and probably many of you quote this passage of Scripture. We've been in the book of Corinthians for a number of weeks. in and out of the book, and we're coming back to the book, drawing inspiration from the book. And 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17 says that we are a new creation in Jesus Christ. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature, a new creature. It says, old things are passed away, behold, all things are become new. A change takes place in your life and mine. We've heard it many, many times. But I'm telling you this morning that the change has to take place of some kind, of some sort, some fashion in your life. You better take and do an examination. Say, Pastor, well, I prayed the sinner's prayer, but you didn't understand what sin is then. Because when you don't understand what sin is and you pray the sinner's prayer, there comes a change that takes place in your life. It might be by little steps. There might be a dramatic change all at once, but there is a continual ongoing work of grace in your life because you have become a new creature in Christ Jesus, a new creation. And what happens? The Holy Spirit of God comes in you. What happens after you trust Christ? Well, you become a new creation. But you become something else. Go with me to the Gospel of John. John chapter 6. You know, when I trusted the Lord, I trusted the Lord as a young person. I don't know, maybe 6 or 7 years of age, maybe a little younger than that, even, I don't know, somewhere in that age span. But there was a time in my life that I struggled with assurance. I didn't have the assurance that I needed to have as a believer in Jesus Christ. I knew what I did. I knew I asked the Lord to come into my heart, and there was some evidence of change in my life. Not near the evidence of change that I was going to see as I began to get into the Word and study the Word and walk closer to Him. Then I began to see more transformation take place in my life. But the Lord gave me some verses of assurance. You see, what happens when you trust the Lord, you're not only a new creature in Christ Jesus, but you have a new promise that you're His and that you belong to Him. Listen to what it says in John chapter 6, verse 37. It says this, all that the Father giveth to me, him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. Now that's the Lord talking. That's vertical assurance. I've written in my Bible, vertical assurance. I have vertical assurance. I have a promise from God Himself that all that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. And then verse 38, for I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of Him that sent me. And this is the Father's will which has sent me, that all of which He hath given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. In my Bible, I have written down divine ownership. Divine ownership. I belong to Him. I have been bought with a price. And then as I read on down in the verse 40, it says this, and this is the will of Him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son, and I seen the Son in the basement of my home as a lost young person. I recognized I was a sinner. I recognized that my sin was going to take me to hell. And I recognized that Jesus Christ came and died upon the cross for my sin. And I knew what the Word says, that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Did I have a theological degree? Not at all. I'd only had a Sunday school teaching degree. I had a Sunday school teacher that gave me the third degree. She gave me John 3:16, and that was the only degree that I needed to have at that point in time in my life. And when I got that degree and understood that degree, that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Listen, it says, all which seeth the Son and believeth on Him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. Friend, that's a finished transaction. That's a finished transaction. I have written that in my Bible. That is a finished transaction. The Bible says in John 10:28, I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. But is that all there is? Well, there's a lot of people that live their life that way. They come to Christ, they get saved, they have a little bit of assurance, they come to church on Sunday morning, they go home Sunday afternoon, and they live their life that way. 365 days out of the year, live that life until they grow old, give up, and die. But you know, that's not all there is to your Christian life. Did you know that? There's more to your Christian life than just that. Take your Bible and turn with me back to the book of Matthew, chapter 16. Matthew, chapter 16. You see, remember those toilet paper rolls I told you about? Good sanctified illustration this morning, isn't that? You go home this morning, you're going to ask somebody in your family to come home for dinner, you're going to say, what the preacher talk about toilet paper? But you'll remember it. That's your vision of what you had of the gospel. If that's the only vision you've got of the gospel, what the gospel does, in your life. It's like looking down the rolls of those toilet paper rolls. You haven't got a very big vision. I guarantee you, when you get into the Word, begin to study the Word, God begins to reveal to you that you have. He didn't just save you to sit here and soak and go home and do that 365 days out of the year, grow old and die. No, sir. He saved you because he has a new purpose for you as a believer in Jesus Christ. He says in Matthew chapter 16 and verse 24, he said, "Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me," did you come after him? Well, many of you shared testimony last Sunday night when you came after him. You recognized your need. You recognized your lost condition. You recognized you were going to hell, and he had the prescription. It might have not been John 3:16. It might have been Romans 10, whatever, 10:13, whatsoever. But he had to do the prescription for your soul. And when you heard the prescription, conviction took place in your heart, and you called out to him. He says, "If any man will come after me," then he says, "let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." We have a new purpose. We have a new purpose, and we should want to follow Christ. And in following Christ, what is involved in following Christ? Well, obviously, there's growing that is involved in following Christ. You and I start out as a baby Christian, and as a baby Christian, we need discipleship, and we need to learn how to feed ourselves, eat the right things, have role models, be held accountable, just a number of things that are involved in the growing process. But when you look at this verse of Scripture, I think this verse of Scripture is speaking about our walk of obedience. Don't you think so? Our walk of obedience. It's more than just taking the Lord's table, what you're going to do next Sunday. It's more than follow the Lord in believers' baptism, which we're not going to do next Sunday. Too cold for that, right? Now, I know, Charles, down south, you cut a hole in the ice. But up north, I don't cut no holes in no ice. If you want to get baptized, you wait till it warms up just a fuzz till the ice is not on the pond, and then we'll talk about it. But listen, the Bible says that there needs to be the act of obedience that takes place in your life and my life, and that involves our surrender. Our surrender, that we take up our cross and we follow him. I've learned that if there's one thing the devil will attack in your life and my life, it's our devotion to him, our obedience to Jesus Christ. He will attack that. He will distract you with other things to keep you from your purpose. He did that with Samson. My land, the Lord had a great plan and a great purpose for Samson. He equipped Samson to do some mighty great things, but what happened in Samson's life? He got mightily distracted, did he not? Did he live his life to his fullest potential? I really don't think he did. I think because of Samson's great distraction, he lived his life far from his fullest potential. Listen, if you and I want to live right, then you and I have got to do something. You and I have got to acquire a taste for the truth of God's Word. You and I have got to acquire a taste for the truth of God's Word. If you're going to take up your cross and you're going to follow him, you and I have got to acquire a taste for the truth of God's Word. And if you don't, you won't stand very long carrying your cross. You will put down that cross and you will fail to be what God ordained you to be. Look what it says in verse 25. It says, "For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it." What you treasure is what you're going to pursue, what you're going to follow after. You know, these Corinthians, we've been talking about the church of Corinth, these Corinthians certainly lived not taking up their cross, would you say? They gave testimony to the fact that they had saving faith, but when you examine this church, as we have examined this church for a number of weeks, they certainly didn't have a taste for the truth of God's Word. Had they had a taste for the truth of God's Word, it would have affected the way they lived their life. And you know, this morning, people, there's a lot of Christians in the same boat. There's a lot of Christians, like it says here in verse 25. It says, "For whosoever will save his life shall lose it." People value that which is temporal more than they value that which is eternal. And we come to church and we put on the dog, but the truth of the matter is we need a real strong lesson in obedience. If you want to be a strong Christian when the storms are raging, you better have a taste for the truth of God's Word. to be a strong Christian in tough times, we have to make some important choices about living the Christian life. All around us are the remnants of the old past life. Right? Remember when you came to Christ? Remember when you trusted the Lord as your Savior? Wherever you trusted the Lord from. Your old friends, your old habits, the old ways, the old books, the old websites. Well, back in my day, there was no websites. But there was music, and there was habits, and there was things of that nature. Listen, when you come to Christ, you need to make a decision that you're not going to go back to those things.
Amen.
You need to make a decision you're not going to go back to those things. You need to make a decision that you're going to acquire a taste of the truth of God's Word. And as you're around God, as you're around His Word, you decide that you better burn some bridges. Because if you don't burn some bridges, you're not going to carry your cross. And at the end of the day, when you come to the end of this life and you're laying on your deathbed and you have the last few cognitive moments as you're laying on your deathbed, you want to be able to look back and say, you know what, I've ran the race and I've ran it to the best of my ability. And I've given my best to the Lord here on this earth, whatever many years that the Lord has given me. You want to be able to look back and be able to say you've done that. Because if you look back upon your life laying on your deathbed, and you haven't given your best to the Master, it's going to be wasted years. Why? Because you valued that which was temporal more than you valued that which is eternal. How are we to be strong in a broken world? Well, look what it says in Matthew chapter 16, again in verse 25. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Verse 26 says, for what is a man profit if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Terry and I was talking Wednesday night. Bill Gates, how many thousand acres, Terry? 240,000 acres. He's the largest landowner. You can acquire everything there is under the sun and die. You don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And you know, it's a shame, but there's going to be a lot of Christians that are only going to be saved by the old expression, by the skin of their teeth. Not that we're saved by our works, no, we're not. We're saved by faith through grace. But once we're saved, our faith commands us to work for Him, to serve Him. What shall a man be profited if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? What shall a man give in exchange for his soul? How are we to be strong in a broken world as a Christian? Because we're living in a broken world. It's as broken can be. And it's getting more brokener than it was last Sunday when I preached. There's a storm coming. You just read the newspaper and listen to the internet and what's going on. It is a broken, sin-sick, broken world. But you know what? You and I don't have to. We serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And if you and I have a taste for the truth of God's Word and will get into the Word and surround yourself with the teaching of the Word of God and God's people in the church, we can be productive in these difficult days for His glory. I believe that God intends, even in the difficult hours of life, the gospel is still to be preached and proclaimed from the pulpit and to be lived out in your life and my life in the public arena. Now let me tell you something. That might mean we might experience some persecution of believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. The things we hold to, the things we believe in, and the things we certainly preach. We might become marked in this culture today. Who would have thought that in the United States of America, that anybody that supported Donald Trump needs to be purged? The word I came across it this past week. You might not have supported him, that's your problem. I'll pray for you. But needs to be purged. And words like prominent people are saying, we need to be repurposed. I like to use the word reconstituted. You know, you dry something out, you freeze dry something out, however you in your dehydrator. Not freeze dry, but in your dehydrator. And then you have to reconstitute it. Well, they're saying we need to be reconstituted. And in essence, they're saying we're brain dead. I'm not brain dead. I know who's in control. That's Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and He's on the side of truth. I read an article the other day of all the millions of condemnation that was leveled against Saddam Hussein called the Butcher Baghdad. I fear after this administration gets done, it's going to make the Butcher of Baghdad look like a piker. But you know what, church? In these difficult days, God still calls us to stand up for Him. And He prayed for me, and He prayed for you that you would stand for Him in these difficult days. Your faith is going to be put to the test. What you claim, what you hold to, you show up on Sunday morning, praise God, glory to God, raise holy hands. Oh, let me tell you something, sister. Let me tell you something, mister. Hang on. Hang on. Your faith is going to get put to the test. We're going to find out whether or not it's really real or not. We're going to find out whether it's real or just all fluff. Fluff. Fluff doesn't sustain you much, does it? Listen, you get an appetite for the things of God, the things of His Word, that Word begins to build you up and strengthen you. Paul said in the book of Philippians, he said, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God which is in Christ Jesus. That doesn't mean when everything is going good I do that. That means when everything is going wrong, I still press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God which is in Christ Jesus. There's no retreat. There's no surrender. My faith stands. Just like old Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had that old time religion, I know, right? My faith stands in those difficult times when the old fiery furnace is out there. My faith stands when my name and the rule of the land says you don't do this, but if you do do this, you're going to be thrown into the lions. Then no, no, my faith's still going to have to stand. If it's real, amen, it's going to stand. And my faith's going to stand when that old adulteress that came after Joseph said, no, 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 I'm not going down that road. His faith stood. Listen, our faith is going to be tested. The question before the house is, are we a strong man or are we a strong woman? What did we learn back in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 9? The Bible says, I keep under my body and I bring it into subjection. What are we to do in these difficult days? Paul says in the book of Philippians, holding forth the word of life. Why is that? Well, take your Bible and turn with me to Philippians chapter 2 and verse 6. Paul tells us why. Verse 16, he says, holding forth the word of life. Why? That I may rejoice in the day of Christ. What is the day of Christ? It is the rapture of the church. That I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. I don't want to be laying on my deathbed and ready to go out into eternity and look over my life and say of my life, the life that I've lived here, I have ran it in vain. I've wasted the years. I've wasted my time. I've wasted that which God has equipped me like He gave Samson. A special ability to be used in a mighty way, but Samson got deterred from using what God had given him. And what happened? He didn't live up to his potential. I want to live up to my potential. And listen, people, for that to happen, what has to happen? We need to burn some bridges to the past so we don't get sucked back into where we came from. And that's what happened to the Corinthians. And you know what? It can happen to you and I this morning. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, go with me back to 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 5. Listen to what it says this. It says, for we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Christ's sake. Listen, people, we're under new lordship. We have new marching orders. This life of Christ, the life of Christ is in me, and the life of a Christian is dying to the life I used to live and being alive to this new life of Christ in me. There will be challenges. There will be tests. There will be temptations. If we live faithfully, though, we need to keep our eyes upon the prize. How do I live in a fallen world? Look what it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. In verse 16, it says this. It says, for which cause we faint not? For which cause we faint not? We have a cause, do we not? As a church, what is our cause? Holding forth the word of life. For which cause we lay down the cause, right? Just because things are going a little tough, right? No, no. For which cause we faint not? We don't retreat. We don't. don't surrender from that which we've been called to do, for which cause, he says, we faint not, though the outward man perish, though things change, though the world's changed, though I change physically, though the outward man perish, it says, yet the inward man has an appetite for the truth. Is renewed, it says, day by day. For which cause we faint not? The cause is the cause of Christ. That comes first. That's the inside job. It took place in your heart when you came to know Christ as your Lord and Savior. That's the cause when you picked up the cross and you begin to follow Him. Listen, Jesus foreseen this hour coming upon the world, and He has prayed for your faith and my faith that it would stand in this hour. There is power there, and it's available, but you and I have to have a taste of the Word of God. Get into the Word. Start digesting the Word, reading the Word, studying the Word. Gather with God's people. Don't gather with NCSI. That's not going to give you any strength at all. It's going to sap your strength. Gather with God's people. Get rid of bad partnerships. Come together with God's people. Take up your cross. A lot of times people say things like this. Well, why do bad things seem to just keep happening to me in my Christian life? Well, go back with me back to the book of Matthew, because that ties in with what we've been talking about. Matthew chapter 16, again, verse 25, it says, for whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Priorities. Priorities. If church isn't important in your life, then something's wrong with your spiritual life. If the Word of God and prayer is not important, well, you say, preacher, I really do pray for the church. Well, you know, you should come together and pray with the church corporately, too. That's important. That's important that we corporately come together. But if priorities are not important in your life, listen, you're putting yourself in a position to fail. If God's Word and His church is not important, you're putting yourself in a position to fail, to drop your cross, not be faithful to the cause. You want to be faithful to the cross? You want to succeed? You want to be an overcomer and not being overcome? Then have some godly priorities in your life. Your life, your belief, what you hold to is your doctrine. And you propagate that doctrine to people who are watching your life, whether you want to believe it or not. We were studying last Sunday night. A neat verse of scripture that I've read it many times and I've quoted it many times. But it tells us in Titus chapter 2 that young men are to be incorrupt in doctrine. Titus chapter 2 verse 7. And Paul is teaching Titus about establishing the church on the island of Crete, and he's talking about the aged men, the aged women, the younger ladies, and the young men. And one of the points he said about the young men, he spoke about doctrine. Now, I said this morning, you propagate a doctrine whether you want to believe it or not. You say, well, I know what doctrine is. Well, you say you might know what doctrine is, but the life you live propagates the doctrine you really hold. You understand that? The life you live propagates the doctrine you hold to. When the king came into the presence of Daniel, he respected Daniel mightily. Because Daniel wasn't like a lot of the other Jewish boys. You know why? Because his doctrine, the life he lived, what he held to, what governed his life, what made him the man that he was, what made Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego the men that they were, it was the doctrine that they held to. What influenced their life? What influenced their conviction? What influenced their soul? In a hostile environment, as Jewish captives, they stood up respectfully, by the way. They just didn't get in the face of the king, because if you know anything about Nebuchadnezzar, he was a composite of Hitler, Mussolini, Saddam Hussein. He was a wicked dude. And yet, what was on the inside of them was an inside job. It could not deny it. They could not but be faithful to it, because it was real. Is it real on the inside of you? Is Jesus Christ really, really real in your life? Soul searching time. For all of us, not just you, but me too. Men say, well, I know what I'd do in a time of war. I'd get my M60 out, and I'd pull that M60. Right, Richard? That big old heavy-duty M60? You know all about it, don't you? John, you know about the M60? If you don't know about it, it's a machine gun. 7.62 NATO round it shoots. On a belt chain. I just get that thing out, and I just shoot Viet Cong left and right. You know what? You don't know what you will do, Junior, until you're in the middle of it. You can talk the talk all day long, but you don't know what you're going to do till you get into the fight. Yes, when you get into the fight, we'll know where your doctrine is. We'll know where your doctrine is. Your doctrine, who you are, what you hold to, your neighbors see it, your family sees it. Well, we were studying about young men and their doctrine. Now, this might bore you to death, but it excited me when I studied it and came across it. There were two words for doctrine. And I had to spell them out in my notes the way they're said, but that's not the way they're spelled. I'm sure of that. Didaskalia and didasko. That sounds like Tim Conway saying something, doesn't it? Didaskalia. And didasko. Didaskalia is the doctrine of the head that is acted out on Sunday. But on Monday, I crack a cold one. On Tuesday, I watch some funky flicks that probably I should not, well not probably, definitely should not be watching as a believer. That's didaskalia. That's the doctrine of the head that is acted out on Sunday. But didasko is the doctrine that Daniel had, that Joseph had, that Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego had. Because their religion was the old time. Real, honest to goodness. Religion in the foxhole that was real. Didasko. What was wrong with Corinth? They had didaskalia. They had the religion of the head. It was acted out. Raised the holy hands, paraded on the stage, lights, camera, action, smoke. But when the fire started flying and the bullets started flying, when sacrifice was called for, they didn't show up. Do you know another church like that? The Church of Laodicea. Depicting the church of the last days. You're living in it. If you don't believe you're living in it, stay after class. We'll talk about it. Listen to the news. Read the newspaper. You would have never dreamed what we're seeing today in the United States of America. But we're seeing it. We are on the beginning of being a socialist state. What's next? Well, we're going to find out who are the didasko Christians. We're going to find out about our doctrine. Whether or not it's real. Whether or not we'll stand. Whether or not we have a head knowledge. Whether or not we're like Corinth. I want you to know that 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ, before he went to the cross, he prayed that you and I would be didaskalos. That you and I would stand, that you and I would be strong in this hour. Friend, if you're going to be strong, number one, you've got to love the truth.
Amen.
There's no other way around it. And your doctrine will definitely show. You say, preacher, I've heard all the messages. I don't care if you have heard all the messages. If your heart's right with God, the Spirit finds a way to teach you a little tidbit of truth. You know, your wife makes chocolate chip cookies. You say, well, she'd make chocolate chip cookies. I'm not going to eat them no more. Right. She just keeps making them. You'll just keep shoving them in, won't you? Why? Because you've got an appetite, right, for chocolate chip cookies. Or maybe see you like peanut butter. Peanut butter cookies. Maybe you like them. Why? Because you've got an appetite. know why we have the didascalia of Christianity? The religion of the head that's acted out, but it's not what it ought to be in the heart? Because we don't have an appetite for the truth of God's word. Now, can that be fixed? Yes, it can be fixed. Number one, if you're born again, you need to recommit yourself to the Lord and say, Lord, I have not been where I should have been, and I am sorry for where I have been. I'm sorry, and I want to get back to where I need to be. That's the first thing that needs to happen. You need to come back home to the Father and say, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you, and I am sorry. Forgive me. Over with. Start being faithful. Or you're here and don't know the Lord. What needs to happen? You need to come to Jesus. You need to be born again. Why? Because you're a sinner. You're lost. I'm not telling you something that all the rest of us are not. All the rest of us are sinners, but we're saved sinners. We've come to Christ, and we've confessed our sin and asked Him to forgive us. And He's come into our heart, and He's saved us, and our sin is covered by the blood. And we daily have to look into this book and examine our life daily before Him. Why do we do that? Because we love Him. We want to serve Him. We want to be the man and woman He called us to be. But you'll never be what He wants you to be until, first of all, you come to know Him as your Lord and Savior. But I want you to know, He prayed for you. He prayed for you that you could become that man or that woman. Father, we thank You for the word this morning. Bless it to our heart. We believe You have blessed it to our heart. We've sensed Your presence in this sanctuary this morning. We believe this morning that the Holy Spirit has preached this message into the hearts of believers. And even in the hearts of some maybe who are not believers. The not believers need to be saved. And there are believers that have been, their doctrine is not what it should be, and they know that. And there needs to be the repentance, there needs to be confession. And then there needs to be the willingness to turn from where they've been and begin to become obedient to You again. You're right where they left You. And Father, we just pray. You'll have Your way in this invitation that we'll do what we should do as believers. And we pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Take your hymnal and turn to page 387. Let's all stand. We'll sing a verse of this song. Let the Lord speak to your heart and do what the Lord tells you to do. 387.
Father, we just thank you for this day that we can come out and worship you. We just thank you for this good message, Lord. We just pray that each one of us would apply it to our life and go out and be that witness for you. And if we have anything in our life that ain't right, we just pray that we bring it to you and lay it at your feet and leave it. And we just thank you for this day. Be with us as we go our separate ways. Guide and direct us and watch over us.